Let's talk about printing on polyester and polyester blended garments. When we talk about printing on poly and polyester blends, it's not about printing onto a nice smooth fabric or how easy it is. You know, we don't have to worry about matting fibers when we're printing on standard polyester. There are some polyesters that are deliberately fuzzy that we have problems on. We're talking about the joys of dye migration, bleed, also called dye sublimation. And to explain that, I first need to give a little bit of information for those who don't currently know how, you know, the shorthand of how polyester is colored. In order to get this nice bright red or this gray foundation that we have here, you first start with white polyester thread. That is put into a vat. In one way or another, it's put into color. And then that color goes into the thread, is absorbed. There's a lot of different mechanisms to get it into the thread. But then once it's there, it is set. And it's set by using heat. And this is where we start talking about in the industry high energy or low energy dyes. Low energy dyes simply mean that they used less heat to set the dye in the fabric, and high energy means that they're using more heat, higher levels of heat, in order to set that dye. It means low temperature heat set or high temperature heat set. Now, how that relates to us and what we do, that temperature directly relates to how hot the garment gets, one, during flashing, and two, during the cure process, which is why some of those garments that you print on, you can use your standard low bleed ink, goes through the dryer and you see zero issues. There is no dye sublimation at the end of your dryer, and there is no dye migration over time. If you are printing on a garment that has those high values, like the cationic, the ST350 from Sanmar is a great example, or if you're printing on cheaper polyester fabric, it's gonna use lower energy dyes, it's gonna be heat set at a lower temperature. That means that you are going to have big challenges when you are trying to print on that garment and keep the ink itself from changing color. So, the focus of this video is how do we go about doing that? There are two tools. One is your polyester white, everyone's favorite. Get your arm workout in by stirring that ink up. Get another arm workout in by pulling that ink. There's no good answer to a good polyester white. They're all pretty darn thick. There are a couple on the market that are of a higher price point that are easier to print, but of course a lot of us don't gravitate to that higher cost. We think that we can struggle through it. Just pay the higher price for a better poly white. Your arms are gonna thank you. Your production time is going to thank you when you are just able to produce faster. So you got your polyester white, but poly white isn't enough on a lot of garments. Even a low cure poly white is not necessarily enough for all your garments. If I took this garment here, the one that has the dye sublimation on it, and of course this one here, and I just printed poly white on them, I'd probably get good results on this red polyester garment. I wouldn't see any shift in the white to a pink over time. But on this one, the one that is noticeably more challenging, I would absolutely see this hexachrome pattern come through the poly white. Ask me how I know. So I actually, last place I worked, we didn't know at the time, so we printed on there. Looked great at the end of dryer. We didn't see any sublimation of the hex pattern coming through. It wasn't until a few days later that we saw that coming through the print and we're like, oh. Now, in the case of the artwork, it actually enhanced the print a little bit. It looked really neat, and that was how we ended up selling it to the customer, was it a little bit of an added benefit. But the solution to that is using what's known as a barrier base, whether that's a barrier black or a barrier gray. You print that down first. There's a special product in there that almost eliminates any sublimation or migration that you're gonna have over time. Now, I've used a couple of words here that I have not explained. Dye migration happens over time. Just like any migration in the world, it takes time for that to migrate, whether that's animals, people, whatever. Sublimation, where you hear about sublimation mostly in our industry, is in creating a design on a product. You're taking the dyes on the paper, placing it on the polyester, hitting it with heat, and then exactly what we're talking about here, dye migration. Those dyes on the paper turn to a gas and absorbed by the polyester thread. Very, very similar to how we colored the polyester thread the first time. But these are all low energy, very low energy sometimes. And that again is going to want to come out when it gets hot. And that term is sublimating. It's a sublimation of the dyes. So you're gonna hear that a couple of ways. So when I use it, I'm using it, sublimation is always right at the end of the dryer because it's a direct result of the heat. Migration is over time. It happens slower, moves through the ink slowly. You can see it as soon as an hour. Usually you're gonna see it over the course of days, maybe even weeks, before you see that effect. As I talked about earlier, the design that I printed the last place I was at, we saw that come through over the course of a week. How do the barrier products work? The barrier grays and the barrier blacks. Other than the chemistry that's used to just help to slow down or mitigate any of that dye coming out of the fabric, you have that basic chemistry in your ink itself, very similar to a poly white, but you're using a form of activated charcoal as your primary mitigator. That charcoal is basically the same thing that you use in, that you see most commonly in water filters. If you have a Brita water filter or something else that's filtering out your water, that's what it is, it's activated carbon. And how that works is the particle itself of the carbon, it's very much like pumice or volcanic rock in that it has a lot of holes, channels, it's got a lot of little caves and pathways in it. Just like with water, the minerals and the stuff that you want removed gets trapped in that charcoal. When we're talking about the dye in polyester fabric, that dye comes out and takes those same paths as those minerals in the water. It ends up getting trapped by that carbon in the ink. Somebody who's smart is gonna go, well, carbon's black and we're using that black in our black ink, I'll just print black ink. Different. It is a different form of black pigment. Yes, you can get it from carbon. There are also other ways to get that black and different forms of that carbon. In this case, it's the activated charcoal, activated carbon, and that's what's being used. Don't ask me any more deeper details on that. I want to know a little more. I just haven't dug into it. And that's what's trapping all those dyes. So if you just use an off-the-shelf black, it's not going to do the same thing. I have talked to people in the past. This has been a point of conversation for over 20 years that I've been in the industry. For those who are doing it and saying that they're seeing great results, it's a placebo effect. What's happening is you're, instead of having like a print that's 2 layers thick, now you've got a print that's 3 layers thick. And what's happening is it's taking a little bit longer for that heat to go through that ink layer all the way to the bottom and to agitate and activate the dyes there to get them to turn to a gas again. So having that extra layer is actually a barrier of protection in terms of just slowing down the heat before it activates the dyes in the fabric to agitate them so that they come through and change the color of your ink. Once you hear the mechanics of the whole thing, you're like, oh, this totally makes sense. You print down this barrier layer through a 110, by the way. You don't want to go through much more than a 110 because you know, volume of ink deposit is king. The more ink you put down, the more dye you're going to actually stop and mitigate from transferring through. If you try to get away with a really thin layer, you can overwhelm the carbon that's in that ink and trapping and locking those dyes, and then you overwhelm your ink. Just think of it as a dam. You know, that dam can only hold back so much water. With all the hurricanes that we've been having lately, there's lots of talk about dam and water flow. Think of a bad poly shirt, like one of the hurricanes that's been going through lately, and the barrier, literally a barrier, just being overwhelmed. So you want to have enough down there that you're able to control all the dyes that are trying to come through. To recap, blocker gray or blocker black low mesh count screens. All technical data sheets reference 86 to 110 mesh. No one recommends going through anything higher than a 110. Again, because of volume of ink deposit. Once you have that, print your white on top. It is always encouraged to print your poly white on top of your barrier black as another level of protection. Again, we're creating a barrier, we're creating a dam, we're holding back that flood of the dyes that are gonna come out of the fabric. And then print your color on top as normal. Now, how do you go about managing your color separations? In the case of this design here, I use the barrier black as the black in my design. So the barrier black is literally a solid print of the entirety of the design. And then the white base is exactly where I need it, and it is absolutely on top of that barrier black. It does not overlap at all. You cannot and should not ever have your ink overlap where that barrier is at. Then after that white is printed, then I print my colors on top. All of this is flashed after each color. There is no print flash print on this design. To further talk about your separations, you're literally creating a Lego brick wall. You're putting down a Lego brick on the board of your black, putting down another Lego brick right on top of it of your white, putting down one more Lego brick on top of that, that is your color. It is a wall. So if you look at it from edge on, yeah, you see strata there. But if one of those was to overlap and touch the shirt, the dyes from that shirt are gonna go straight up that little bit of ink that's touching and then halo into your design. So if you had yellow on that edge of your design and you had a black shirt, that black is gonna come right up and darken up that yellow. Further example, on a blue, it's gonna come right up that yellow and it's gonna turn it green. Is there any way to keep down the screen needs for doing this? Sorry. The only way to do that, of course, is by combining your barrier base with your black in your design, but that's only if you're using a barrier black type product. Currently, I know of the one from FN and I know of one from One Stroke that sells a black. The others that I've looked up, they only sell a gray. Now, a lot of people like the gray. They like printing a gray because they don't have to print a white underlay. They can print another color right on top and it looks great. Of course, this looks great for them and for their customer. But when we're talking about reproduction, which is typically where I come from when I'm doing all this explanation, putting a white on top of it is still recommended. There are plenty of times, like in this case, where I'm printing a light gold, where if I don't have a white underneath there, that color shifts. Even on a gray, that color is going to shift. So it is encouraged that you do things the right way, at least in the beginning, and then you can find your shortcuts from there. One final thing to understand about these barrier products, some of them are going to have a little bit of a gritty feel, and it's not always consistent from batch to batch. This goes into the world of getting that raw material, the activated carbon. We're always looking for a specific grade, a very fine grade of that carbon. But from manufacturing batch to manufacturing batch of that carbon, there can still be inconsistencies. One of the things that particles like this like to do is they soak up everything around them. And that includes, of course, those minerals in the water and the dyes in the polyester. But they also like to absorb liquids. And when they absorb liquids, they can swell a little bit. So again, from batch to batch, sometimes you're gonna get a container of ink from whoever your manufacturer is, and it can feel a little gritty. That's just that particulate absorbing some of the liquids in the ink and getting a little bit bigger. It's not gonna hurt you. It's not gonna hurt the ink. It's not gonna damage anything. This is also part of one of the reasons why, when we talk about mesh count, we don't want you to go above a 110 mesh. Try to keep it at that as your maximum, because that particulate can get hung up in your mesh. All right, I think that's gonna do it for talking about printing on polyester. If you have any further questions about how to print on polyester, and trust me, there's gonna be a million questions about printing over polyester. Load them down below in the comments. You know, I'll get back to you on all that and we'll talk a little bit deeper. If there's some really good questions, we'll turn that into another video. As always, like and subscribe. If you know someone who's been struggling with printing on polyester and controlling dye migration, send them this video. Thank you all very much for watching. See you in the next one.